We have innovative prevention and early intervention program that's the first of its kind in the country. We have a workforce education and training program, a capital facilities and technological needs program, and an innovation program. The primary purpose of the commission is twofold. First, we want to expand services to Californians in need of mental health services, those who are severely mentally ill, and we want to ensure funds and services are accessible and are being utilized in the most effective way possible. Those are our two main goals. In addition, up to 5% of the funding received through the program is provided for state administrative and oversight activities. The commission budget is a part of the overall act per Prop 63, and from these dollars we fund our overhead and our staff and all of those things. But additionally, we also fund program enhancements. For example, just recently, $32 million matched with $22 million of federal Medi-Cal reimbursement funds are going out to what is called triage grants. And that came out of this 5%. The legislature passed into law SB 82, and it provides those $32 million, and they're now just heading out to counties. They will include putting workers in emergency rooms, jails, out on the streets, and our goal is to intercept crises at the earliest possible time for the client so we can divert them to services as early as possible and get them the best possible service. The commission approved approximately $31 million for the fiscal year 2014-15, so we have a little bit left over that we're going to push out to additional counties. Today, more than 2 million adults in California, which is about 8% of our population, are affected by a potentially severe mental illness every year. It's a large percent of our population, and we have not yet been able to serve all of them. Over the past couple of years, there have been significant changes that have impacted our services and the Act and the Commission specifically. And these changes include the elimination of the Department of Mental Health that happened in the fiscal year 2012-13. And in addition, ADAP, the Alcohol and Drug Programs, was eliminated in 2013-14. So many of those responsibilities shifted. An additional change was that the Act funds used to go through the commission, and now they're released directly to the counties without state approval for funding or programs, with the exception of the innovation program component. So those funds are just pushed out directly to counties. A statutory mandate to develop a five-year evaluation master plan for measuring client outcomes in the community-based mental health system was also a change. We've invested a significant time and money in this effort, because certainly you can do all the good work you want in the world, but if you can't prove it, you certainly can't sustain success. So this has been a very important effort that we've invested a lot of time and money in doing. The shifting of the significant responsibilities for public mental health from the state to the counties and the elimination of the Department of Mental Health and ADAP requires that oversight and accountability for our public mental health system be carefully thought out to produce the best results for our citizens in need and the policymakers involved in making these critical decisions about funding. The commission is the only state entity that has as its sole responsibility the oversight of California's community mental health system. How are you, Assemblyman? Good. With funding now going directly to counties, the commission has refocused our efforts, as I said, on evaluation and drafting statutory regulations to guide counties going forward. So we have a number of statutory responsibilities that are set forth in the Act, and I'm just going to name a few of them. We advise the governor and the legislature regarding actions that the state may take to improve the care of people with mental illness. We ensure dollars are expended in the most effective, cost-effective manner, and services are provided in accordance with recommended best practices and, of course, with the law, with the Act. ensuring that we include the perspective and participation of our diverse community members. This has been a very important piece for us to make sure that those suffering from mental illness, including family members and all diverse communities, are involved in the decision-making processes that we have going forward to help provide the best services. We're developing strategies to overcome stigma and discrimination, which is dovetailed on that. And we improved the county innovation programs. We receive and review county three-year programs and expenditure plans, annual updates. We adopt regulations for programs and expenditures for prevention and early intervention programs that I mentioned earlier. And we approve the county triage plans that I talked about. And we help provide technical assistance and training to those counties and help develop best practices so that counties can learn from each other to do the best possible job. As I mentioned, evaluation is kind of our top three priorities, really. It's a key activity by which the Commission fulfills our oversight and accountability role, really. The primary audience for this evaluation is the legislature and the governor, of course, and state agencies, but it's also the general public, the taxpayers, and those who need services. Oversight and accountability responsibilities include ensuring that funds are spent in accordance with the Act, and that the funds lead to improvement for the consumers. That's our top priority, to make sure that everything we do leads to better outcomes for consumers. The Commission evaluation activities also serve as a valuable quality improvement role. As I said, we try and provide best practices for counties. We want them to learn from one another. We're not trying to ever punish them, if you will, for not doing a good job. We want to help them do a better job by connecting them with those folks who might have figured out a better way to do it than perhaps they have. So that pretty much wraps up the overview of what we do. If you have any questions, we're happy to entertain those, and any specifics of the program.
Okay. How often do you get reports on in your evaluation of what the counties are doing?
That's a broad question.
There's several different evaluations that are going on at different times. So the deliverables come in at different times according to the contract. So we try and determine through the master plan. There's evaluations laid out in the master plan, and we're trying to adhere to that master plan to ensure that those evaluations that were determined through our evaluation committee and through the commission. So there's a list of evaluations in that master plan, and they all have various different deliverable due dates and different time frames as to when they will be done.
What do you do with the information once you get it? How do you share it with the legislature?
We do annual reports to the legislature. The evaluation master plan is just getting underway.
Okay.
So we'll be providing that input hopefully on a more regular basis than annually to the legislature. We share it with your staff, of course, and the Senate staff. And like I said, the master plan is new, and so we're just trying to figure out what are the best ways to do that. Mm-hmm. If you have suggestions, we're welcome to it.
I was asking because I was in a meeting with some community in San Diego, and they were very concerned that the issue of mental health was not being adequately addressed by the county, and that this was a poor community, and they didn't feel that they were getting whatever services or whatever was necessary. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to figure some things out, and so obviously this money is being pushed out into that to the county.
Not right off the top.
So I'm wondering what kind of reporting are we getting, how do we look, how are we doing in terms of meeting the diverse populations that we're supposed to serve, those kinds of things. Like I said, and it would not have been something that I probably would have focused on had it not been that I was in a meeting.
Sure.
And that was a concern, and evidently they were having this conversation with our county supervisors and what have you about either the community not getting the kind of assistance they felt they needed within areas of mental health, with families and young people and all those kinds of things. And so I was just curious as to how do we get the report, how do we know how well we're doing, those kinds of things.
Well, and I'd be happy to provide you with some San Diego-specific statistics. We don't have them off the top of our head.
Sure, I understand that.
But I'm happy to provide those for you.
Yeah.
San Diego has been a highlight, and mm-hmm. sometimes not quite as much as a highlight in the past of mm-hmm. how they have moved forward with mental health dollars. So mm-hmm. we're happy to provide you with those statistics.
It'd be interesting to see. I promised to be with this community group to find out what their specific concerns were.
Sure.
But it would be.
We'd appreciate hearing that as well, and certainly we'll get you what's going on exactly in San Diego County.
Sounds good. All right, that would be helpful. Any other questions? Okay, do we have any comments from LAO or the Finance Department? I don't think there's anything that's related to that. Do we have any public comments? Thank you very much for coming. Appreciate it, and I look forward to getting that information.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We're now down to the Department of State Hospitals. With issue one in the state hospitals, we'd like to have the staff come forward. We may not have enough space in this little room, I understand, for everyone, so if it's agreeable, we're going to have some of the finance people on the side. Is that correct? Wanted to have some of them? If they'd like to sit there, one at the end, that may be fine. If that's not enough seats, okay. So we don't have to move around too much. That's fine. Great. Thank you very much. Okay. As long as you don't push the button to vote, we're fine. Okay. Welcome.
Thank you very much. My name is Cliff Allenby. I'm acting director of the Department of Hospitals, State Hospitals. When I came on board in January of 2011, we were the Department of Mental Health. We had two major programs. One was oversight of county mental health programs. We also were charged with the management of the Medi-Cal program for local mental health services. And then the other side of the house was where we are today. We had state hospitals. The budget for 11-12 called for basically the realignment of the mental health programs, which meant that we had a significant reduction, and legislation passed, transferred a few of the programs that we were covering to other state departments, but basically gave the authority for local mental health to the counties and reduced the amount of state oversight. I think it was the right thing to do, because what had happened over the years at the oversight had become really process-oriented and not really added value to the level of programs that counties were really doing. They still have the same responsibilities they had prior to the realignment. It's just that the decisions are made locally. They have county mental health plans. They're similar to what they were before, but they don't have to come to the state and go through a process of approval. So we basically, beginning in 2012, became the Department of State Hospitals. But in the process, I began to understand that there were a lot of problems within our system. We had a deficit, as your consultant pointed out, in the budget, and we had at least a difficult time explaining why it happened. It became clear to us as management that we needed to find out what was really going on in our hospital system. And we brought in some retired annuitants to basically look at the administrative side, to look at what needed to be done so that we could have a better system and have better control of what actually was going on in the hospitals. And we did a report at the end of that year basically calling for significant changes. It also became readily apparent to us as management that we needed to do a better job on the clinical side. Our medical director at the time, when we had both local government and state hospitals, was an academic child psychiatrist. We don't have children. And it became apparent to us that what we really needed to do was to have a forensic psychiatrist, a person that had been in the field, who had done and provided clinical care, We brought in Dr. Warburton, who is on my right, who is our medical director, who has practiced in our hospitals providing clinical care and is much more knowledgeable about the kinds of things that we need to do to provide appropriate care. And we are at a point where we're making changes. We've changed the structure of the system. We've basically flattened the organization. All of the EDs at our local hospitals report directly, and they're all across the board. And so there's more interaction with what's going on in Sacramento. And we think we're in the midst of making significant improvements in our capacity to provide clinical care. And what I'd like to do is to have Dr. Warburton kind of give you an idea of the kinds of changes that we've made to give us a better shot at providing forensic care. More than 90% of our patients are attached in one way or another to the criminal justice system, mm-hmm. from not guilty by reason of insanity, incompetent to stand trial, medically disordered offenders, sexually violent predators. So there is a very limited number of patients that are Lanham and Petras short or civil commitments, which means that we have to do a different kind of a job to provide that kind of care. And Kate will give you a brief description of what we've done and what we are doing.
So I'm Kate Warburton. I'm the medical director for the Department of State Hospitals. And when I came on board a couple of years ago, without question, the biggest problem in our system was violence. We'd experienced the murder of a staff member at Napa, where I came from. Our patients were upset. Our staff was upset. And I would say that the biggest problem at that time is we had absolutely no idea why we were so violent or what to do about it. So I'll make a few brief remarks about what we now know about ourselves, and I'm happy to elaborate if you have any questions. We are, by far, by a factor of three, the largest forensic system in the country. We have almost three times as many forensic patients as the state of Florida, more than three times New York, and no one else is even close. One out of every three patients admitted to our facilities is physically violent at least one time during their hospital stay with us. And most people are admitted to us one way or another because they're violent. What was the state hospital population and what worked in the state hospital population has changed. National media reports and discussions with hospitals in other states confirm this. Change in a state hospital population is not unusual if you look back at the history of public mental health systems. And I think that we, as the largest system in the country, are on the bleeding edge, unfortunately, of this change. And our only defense is to be on the leading edge through science and innovation, which is what we're trying to do. Everything we're doing is in the service of providing quality mental health care to our most vulnerable patients. But in order to do that, we need to acknowledge that we've changed and we need to do things differently. And that's what we've done.
Okay. Yeah. Any other comments of the overview? Any comments from the finance overview? Okay. Any comments from the public? You guys have any comments? Uh-huh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to get a little bit more specific detail on what has changed since 2012 in our state hospitals and in the administration of the state hospitals, because we identified a host of deficiencies and they're detailed in our staff report, and then some recommended changes that were to be implemented. Maybe I've missed it somewhere, but I haven't seen an evaluation of the extent to which those recommended changes have been implemented, and to the extent that they were implemented, what success has been realized with respect to them. So maybe we could get some more detail.
Let me take the administrative side. We clearly didn't have real control so that we couldn't articulate to you what our problems were. And we've made significant changes in that we have a better knowledge today than we did 2 years ago of where we are as a system, where our costs are, where our costs aren't, and how we can manage so that we can stay within our budget and we are going to be doing that, and we will do that, because we have better controls today than we did yesterday. On the clinical side, I'll let Kate talk about it, but we've made significant changes so that we're more proactive in dealing with the patient base that we have today than we did when we had patient base yesterday.
So I would say that the first thing that happened was the development of an entire unit devoted to clinical operations, which we did not have before. So that's my division, the clinical operations division. One of the biggest problems in our system, when I was a practicing psychiatrist in our system, is that if something wasn't working or something was changing or something was of concern, in order to transmit that information to Sacramento, where the decision makers are, as a staff psychiatrist, I'd have to transmit that to my senior psychiatrist, to the chief psychiatrist, to the medical director, to the executive director, to the deputy director in Sacramento. So as you might imagine, raw clinical feedback wasn't happening to the extent that we would have liked. So one of the first things we did is tried to flatten that communication change by hiring one of each discipline that's represented in our system. So we have a team called the Clinical Operations Advisory Council of people who are coming out of the hospitals, who are based in the hospitals, and their job is to be a constant source of assessment and recommendation, as well as a conduit of communication for our clinicians directly to me, so that I'm aware of what's going on with pharmacy all the time, in real time, and it's reality-based. It hasn't gone through the communication change that tends, tends to render information less than accurate. So we have the Clinical Operations Advisory Council, and the first thing that we did, we visit the hospitals twice a year. The job of the people on that council is to get in touch with everyone in their discipline. So we have made efforts to make sure that we have everyone's email address, that when we visit the hospitals, everyone has access to provide input to these individuals or call them on the telephone. We sent out surveys to each discipline asking them what their priorities were for their discipline. We hired a healthcare informaticist to come in and train us on how to deliver efficient, quality healthcare. And the information that we got at that time was that you can't really use informatics or measure things until you have processes in place that make sense. To that end, we spent a year going around looking at all the various clinical delivery processes in our system and determining that we really sometimes we were delivering apples instead of oranges, if that makes any sense. And the reason is because we were not aware of our forensic identity. So we have people who are admitted as incompetent to stand trial. They have vastly different needs than people who are admitted because they're mentally disordered offenders, or people who are civilly committed because they're LPS, or people who are not guilty by reason of insanity. So the overwhelming feedback that we've gotten from our clinicians is that we need to develop and implement commitment-specific treatment pathways that are standardized from hospital to hospital, but different from commitment to commitment. So we are in the process of doing that. Once those processes are in place, we can input or implement outcomes, both process and clinical outcomes measures, to make sure the processes are working and that they're having the desired effect. We also identified risk assessment, specifically violence risk assessment, as a major deficit in our system. If most of the patients that we have are being admitted because they're violent, we need to actually do some sort of comprehensive assessment of that. There's an entire body of literature about evaluating someone's violence risk, so we've provided training throughout our system to all the hospitals in violence risk assessment and implemented various forms of violence risk assessment at each facility. We've also started something called the Psychopharmacology Resource Network, which is a group of psychopharmacologists led by a national expert to do psychopharmacology consults on difficult cases, usually violent cases, and we're measuring outcomes with that. We've implemented dialectical behavioral therapy at one hospital, and we're in the process of training a couple of other hospitals. That's the gold standard for impulsive violence. And we're in the process of fleshing out what is now an analytics unit, where we are constantly looking at clinical data and making decisions based on the data that we have.
So it sounds as though you've undertaken a whole range of changes. and that they're, in most cases, still in the implementation stages. Is that a correct impression?
In one form or another. I mean, we're delivering violence risk assessments. We're delivering psychopharmacology consults. We're measuring outcomes. So, for example, one of the things we've done is try to increase the use of a medication called Clozaril, mm-hmm. which is known to reduce aggression. We have outcomes showing that we've done that. So we're standardizing forms and documentation in the hopes of mm-hmm. being able to standardize these treatment pathways. So maybe I'm being defensive, but I would say...
No, I'm just trying to understand where you are in the process.
Yeah.
And I mean, first of all, nobody knows what was going on before.
That's true.
So we really can't compare where you were to where you are. So the question is, how far have you come in implementing change, and to what extent are you now at this point in a position to have some metrics that you can measure, outcomes you can measure?
I would say we do have some metrics. We're looking at outcomes for, say, Clozaril implementation or DBT implementation. We have seen a reduction in aggression, especially patient-on-patient aggression. You know, the kind of process and clinical outcomes, you know, we can measure length of stay, for example, for an IST patient, but until we have more fine-tuned processes related to their treatment delivery, those outcomes are kind of just like a vital sign. You know, we know they have a fever, but we don't have the CAT scan or the MRI in place yet to understand why they have a fever.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of, in terms of outcomes and understanding ourselves, that's kind of the level we're at. We know patient-on-patient aggression has gone down, but we don't really understand much more than that at this time. But we're implementing those analytics to be able to do that.
When do you anticipate being in a position to more completely assess the impact of the changes you're making and the effect on outcomes?
I'm not exactly sure how to answer that because I see this as a constant ongoing thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we're ever going to be done implementing it because I think it's always going to be changing. The science mm-hmm. is always going to be changing. Hopefully our treatment will always be keeping up with the science. I would say in a year's time, hopefully we'll have at least an analytics unit in place that's getting a little bit more data than just how many people hit each other today, but, you know,
mm-hmm.
some more qualitative information. Was it predatory? Was it organized? Was it psychotic? So, you know, hopefully we'd have that architecture in place in a year.
Mm-hmm.
We won't have longitudinal data at that time.
Right.
So I guess I don't know how to answer your question with just a date.
I would assume part of your exercise is to try to develop a set of outcomes that you would like to measure, and how you get to those outcomes may evolve and change as different techniques are tested or used to get to those outcomes, but that you would establish a set of outcomes that presumably reflect what's desirable to achieve.
Right.
And so let me just add, is that part of what you're in the midst of?
Yes, absolutely. I'm sorry I didn't understand your question. So, for example, outcomes for someone who's incompetent to stand trial. We've gone around and we've had our clinicians help us define them. So we have lists of them.
Okay.
Having the infrastructure in place to collect them and collect them in a standardized fashion is sort of the next trick, if you will. But so, for example, we've identified for someone who's incompetent to stand trial, a process outcome would be how often they're evaluated by their psychiatrist and have a medication change, because one of the issues we've identified is that people are psychotic and incompetent, but we're not getting to them aggressively enough with psychopharmacology. A clinical outcome for ISTs that we've identified is length of stay, because once we restore them to competency, that's a very good indication of whether or not we're doing our job well.
Right.
But length of stay is not a good clinical outcome for a sexually violent predator. So we've decided that wouldn't be something we want to measure. But for those individuals, things like engagement with treatment, quality of life scales, other things to make sure that even though it's the judicial system and not us that has the ultimate say about where they're living, we can at least do what we can to improve their situation in our hospital. So we have lists of all of these outcomes, both process and clinical, for each treatment pathway.
Mm-hmm.
We have 8 facilities. So, you know, standardizing the documentation, we're probably 50 to 75% of the way there standardizing documentation, standardizing audits of that documentation to make sure those treatment pathways are being delivered is sort of the next step. So I understand what you're asking, and I can tell you that we are in the process of it, but I just don't know exactly how long it will take, and I'm hoping that it's always going to be evolving.
Well, I think the modalities and the methodologies may evolve, but presumably, ultimately, you come to a refined set of outcomes that are primarily substantive in nature as opposed to procedural that will give you and the public the ability to make a judgment about how well you are succeeding in what you're trying to do, given any particular category of patient. And so it seems to me you're on a journey here. The question that I have, that I think is going to be a continuing question to the department, is how far along that path are you to the end of that journey? When can we, on behalf of the public, anticipate that you will have established enough in the way of measurable outcomes that we can knowledgeably in an informed way engage in a dialogue about whether we're achieving what we're trying to achieve with respect to those who are in the state hospitals or not? So without taking more time, I would just say I would hope and I would expect that through the course of the balance of this budget cycle, and certainly it sounds like it's going to take into the next budget cycle, that would be something of a priority for the department.
It is a priority.
Mm-hmm. It is a priority, and I think we are doing what you're asking. I think, you know, for things like medical care, it's very straightforward, and we are collecting BMIs and hemoglobin A1Cs and all the objective indicators of medical health, and we have been for some time. It's just harder to define outcomes in mental health populations and forensic mental health populations. And so it's not that we're not working hard, but we are taking our time to make sure that we're picking the right things so that they're meaningful.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Well, thank you very much. Is there any public comment? Yes, the microphone is right there. You'll have two minutes to share with us.
Okay, thank you very much, Madam. I've given a handout to all of you, and basically I appreciate what Mr. Allenby and Dr. Warburton have put out there as far as the state improving since they took over. What I have in front of you is I'm Dr. Bussey from the Union of American Physicians and Dentists. And while we realize that I'm the president, and while we realize that psychiatry is the main reason that the Department of State Hospital exists, a relatively forgotten bunch are the doctors, the medical doctors who work there. And so in a nutshell, I have a memorandum from the medical directors at all of the state hospitals pointing out the stress that they're under and the morale problems they have working with psychiatric patients who have greater morbidities, physical morbidities. They're working not to get into, you know, what their demands are, but they have been felt that some sort of a R&R or some sort of a extra salary would be appropriate, as they are truly laboring under the both the psychiatric and medical problems that the patients here, 1,000 patient each facility has. And on page 10, you have the vacancy rates on your agenda here, and they're even greater, as you can see from the front sheet. The medical doctors have vacancy rates up to 33% in Coalinga, Vacaville, and Napa. These are about 3 months old, these statistics. I'm not quite sure Dr. Warburt, Mr. Allenby could fill it in, but there's quite a bit of vacancy and a lot of workload that the physical doctors have, and they could go to the CDCR, but they are working in a very dangerous and stressful environment, and they would really consider some sort of R&R to be in order. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you very much.
Is it appropriate to respond?
Sure, if you...
I think Dr. Bussey has pointed out a real problem for our department, and we would very much like to come to you today and say we've got it resolved, but we don't. It is a salary impaction or lack of salary, and collective bargaining is a good thing, but it's not perfect, and this is an area that we really need to work to do a better job in compensating the medical side of the house.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. One other comment. Yes. Uh-huh.
I'm not sure. My name is Margaret Johnson, Disability Rights California. I have a comment on issue 4. Do you want me to wait until you take that up?
Yeah, when we get to issue 4.
Okay.
We'll have a public hearing after issue. Okay. Nothing else? Thank you very much. We'll move on to item number 2. Okay. Okay. Okay, you want to begin with item number 2, expansion to address incompetent to stand trial wait list.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Mark Beckley, Deputy Director for Administration, Department of State Hospitals. We are requesting $27.8 million general fund to increase our bed capacity in our state hospital system by 105 beds. What this proposal would do is it would allow us to reduce the wait list for incompetent to stand trial patients. Currently, we have a wait list of over 300 patients waiting for admission to our hospitals, and this proposal would help us to admit those patients and admit them in a timely manner. We also have plans in place to increase admissions at our Atascadero State Hospital by 55 patients. So we think a combination of those two factors should significantly reduce the wait list of patients waiting for admission to our facilities. We're also in the process of expanding our restoration of competency program. That's a program where we treat patients within jail facilities. That program is currently in place in San Bernardino and Riverside counties. We're seeking to expand those to Los Angeles and Alameda counties. And we hope to do that fairly soon. That could reduce our pending admissions by another 50 patients. So we think that a combination of these factors, the additional beds that we're requesting through this proposal, the increase in admissions to Atascadero State Hospital and expansion of the ROC program should allow us to better manage our IST wait list.
Okay.
Sure.
Just a small addition. On the ROC program, we have significantly better outcomes in that the length of stay to become competent is substantially reduced. And one of the reasons that occurs is that not all of the folks that are judged to be incompetent to stand trial are handled within the ROC program, within the regional program. Those are clients that we believe are more likely to be brought back to competency and to require less intervention on our part. For those that are more difficult, even with the ROC program, they will be handled within our hospital system because it requires a lot more interaction and a lot more clinical care than we can provide within the ROC programs. But the ROC program that is in place, and the legislative analyst did a review of it, basically shows that the length of stay for competency in those programs is significantly less than the length of stay within our hospital system. And we think it's a cost-effective and better program. And it's cost-effective to the counties because whether they're provided care in the county or provided care in our hospital system, the cost is borne by the state.
Okay. Any comments from our finance department, LAL? Good one. Mm-hmm.
Sarah Larson with the Legislative Analyst Office. So the administration provided a good description of this proposal, so I'll just move straight to our recommendations. And since our concerns for both this issue and for issue 3 are similar, I'll kind of cover them both at the same time. So our office is recommending that the legislature reject this proposal and request more information from the department about its ongoing needs. And this is for two main reasons. First, we're unclear whether the current budget is an appropriate size or whether savings could offset the requested increases. And second, the high staff vacancy rate means that even if additional funding is provided, it's possible that newly budgeted beds might remain unfilled. So our office is also recommending that DSH contract for an analytically based assessment of their distribution of beds and staffing, and I'll discuss that in just a moment. We do acknowledge that there's been growth in the patient wait list, particularly for the incompetent to stand trial patients, but our concern with this proposal is that it may not be based on an accurate assessment of the department's ongoing needs. So while there's been an increase in certain types of referrals, the department is currently budgeted for more than 500 beds that aren't currently being used. We do recognize that some of those beds are reserved for certain purposes. For example, the department has noted in discussions with us that some beds are for medical purposes or reserved for patients who are out to court. However, we're concerned that the department appears to be consistently over-budgeted in this fashion, and because annual per-patient costs are very high in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, an additional 500 vacant beds represents a substantial amount of savings. In addition, that number of vacant beds does fluctuate, so that does seem to indicate that perhaps the department could be operating with a different volume of vacant beds than it currently has. We're also concerned that the department doesn't have an analytically based bed and staffing model. So, for example, staffing models in the correctional systems include factors like ratios of patients to providers, but also the volume and appropriateness of the number of vacant beds, how those beds should be staffed, the appropriate distribution of bed types, those sorts of elements. And without that sort of information and kind of formula-driven ratio, it's difficult for the legislature to determine whether the requested augmentations are appropriate. Our second concern is that this particular IST proposal is based on the assumption that the department can staff the positions associated with the IST beds. But as noted in the agenda, there are very high vacancy rates at the state hospitals and psychiatric programs. So approving this augmentation could possibly not result in staffing increases because hiring is a challenge. And the additional beds proposed may remain vacant because of that. So in summary, we recommend that the legislature reject the current proposal to provide additional capacity for both the IST and the Coleman patients. We would recommend that they direct DSH to report at May budget hearings on the number of vacant beds at that time, how savings related to those vacancies might be diverted to fund this staffing request or this bed request, as well as reporting on what steps are being taken to address the high vacancy rate. And we also recommend the legislature direct the department to report in May on what progress has been made to expand the patient management programs, for example, the Restoration of Competence program that the department mentioned, because expansion of that program could possibly result in a reduced need for more beds. Finally, we would recommend that the legislature direct DSH to develop a proposal to contract for an independent analysis to determine appropriate numbers of vacant beds, appropriate staffing levels, and other related factors for each facility. So that's all of our recommendations on these proposals, and I know it went kind of fast, so if you guys have any questions on those, I'd be happy to answer them.
Okay. Any other finance report?
Mark Beckley, Deputy Director of Administration for Department of State Hospitals. Just to provide some responses, and we did meet with the LAO, and we really appreciate working with them on these bed capacity issues. Currently, the Department of State Hospitals has a 4% bed vacancy rate. That's approximately 221 beds. The majority of those beds, three quarters, are reserved for specialty services such as geriatric patients, medically needy patients, deaf, visually impaired patients, as well as admissions units. So you need to keep a flow of patients. We also have beds that are reserved for specialty populations, and you really would not want to mix other populations in with these, such as your sexually violent predators. And the Coleman Court beds are ordered by the court, so we don't have an option to use those for other purposes. Overall, in terms of savings, we expend 98 to 99% of our budget So we're really slim in terms of year-end savings, so we don't think that there's much there that would be available for redirection. And in terms of staffing, where we plan on housing these beds in Coalinga, we have not had difficulties hiring staff there, at least contract staff. So we've just opened up a new unit there. It's fully staffed, accepting patients. And that's where these units are proposed to be housed. So we do feel that if this funding is approved, we would be able to fill these beds, and it would have a positive impact on reducing our wait list.
Okay. Any questions from staff, from anyone else? Questions from legislators? Do we have any public hearings?